The Lies of the Third Temple, Part 75. I'm Professor Hannes Redlinghuis of the First Assembly of Yahushua in South Africa, Pretoria, Montana, also international. Should you require any information, have a question, maybe need one of the books which I've written or want to know something about it, please contact us at our WhatsApp number 0722-367-124 or just go to my website. https://yahvah.co.za. If this is the first time that you will participate in the study, you're very, very welcome. But don't just continue here, you've missed quite a bit of information. Go to part one, start from the beginning. You also need to subscribe to the channel, it's very important to receive the notifications of all the other studies that we're busy with. There's a couple of English studies and our TikToks. If you're Afrikaans speaking, you understand Afrikaans, I've got about 2,000 plus messages or videos on YouTube in Afrikaans. You can just go to our website. I just need to give it quickly there. It's the very same website as https://, and it's not Yahvah. Yahushua, the son's name, Yahvah.co.za. That's the Afrikaans one. You can get all the info there. You must please bear with me because there is a lot. There's about 12 million Afrikaans speaking people in the rest of the world who immigrated from South Africa. After you've subscribed to the channel, it's very important to share this with your friends and family for them in order to get the notifications as well. Make sure you have a 1611 King James Bible at least, pen and a notepad. Welcome to Breakfast with Prof. Hannes. I trust that this study is going to be a blessing unto you in the wonderful name of Yahushua, the name above every other name. We are going to continue where we left off yesterday morning. It says, and he, the Antichrist, shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week. 1 week. In the midst of the week, he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offerings. Now, 2-3 times, the researcher shot himself in the foot by saying that he will, after he became the Antichrist, he will sacrifice. You can't. Who's sacrificing in the first half of the time? Now we were talking about Daniel 9 verse 27 versus Daniel 12 verse 11 and Daniel 12 verse 12. The first part of Daniel 9:27 is not sealed up. It's available. It's for everybody, for the whole church world to read and understand. And that's where the confusion comes. Where Daniel chapter 12 is sealed, the whole Daniel 12 chapter 12 is sealed unto the end of time. Or the end time. And then Yahweh will reveal it unto the bride of Yahushua in order to understand all the sealed secrets before the parousia or the coming of Yahushua will occur for his bride. But in the middle of the week he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offerings, and on the wing of abomination shall be one who make desolate. Now listen, signing of the covenant. Now we know it's not 1,260 days, 1,230 days, not 42 months, 41 months, time of false peace. Breaking of the covenant, first period, Daniel 12 verse 11, 1,290 days, which is 43 months. 43 months plus 41 months is 84 months. 1,290 days plus 1,230 days, 2,520 days. Agree. So we're working from the covenant, which is broken. From there, we're working on. Now it says, and on the wing of abomination, after the covenant is broken, on the wing of abomination shall be one who makes desolate. And until the consummation, which is determined, so which was determined by Yahweh already, is poured out on the desolated. What is that? Poured out on the It is the great tribulation in this period. 1290 days plus 1335 days, 2625 days. I know all these things by my mind, because I've been preaching this for many, many, many years, maybe 40 years plus, when I came to this revelation. So what does it say? And then only will it be poured on the desolated. So this earth will be made desolated. Why? How? Through the great tribulation. They will be like ants, eating up everything, like locusts coming through, eating up everything. Now the researcher says, now don't worry about understanding everything in this verse. Now he's talking about Daniel 9:27, which is the 1 week covenant. Because, you see, the problem to the researcher and the whole Protestant church world, charismatics and Catholics, they only have 7 years of Daniel 70 weeks that's left. 2,520 days, 7 years, 84 months. Now they used up, according to them, Daniel 9:27, half of the time. And that's why he would say, you don't worry to understand about everything in this verse. Listen what he says. Now don't worry about understanding everything in that verse. The part you need to understand is that the word week, in the Hebrew word shavoya. Now why would he suddenly use a Hebrew word shavoya? Why don't you use Yahshua's name? If you are a Hebrew, why don't you use Yahshua's name instead of Jesus? The researcher doesn't even know that the letter J never exists until the 16th century. We at least know, according to the internet even, that there was no letter J 2,000 years ago. 4,000 years ago, there was no letter J in the Hebrew alphabet. 2,000 years ago, there was no letter J in the Hebrew or the Greek alphabet. It was only formed in the 16th century. You understand it? In 1524, the letter J was created in order to create the name Jesus. Because his name was Yahshua. The angel said to Miriam, not Mary. Mary is a Greek name. She was a Hebrew lady. Miriam. Even the Muslims know that. It's in their Quran. They know more than the Protestants and the Charismatics and the Catholics together. So what happens? The angel says to Miriam, Matthew 1:23, you will bear a son. You must call his name Yahshua. The father's name is Shua. Father's name Shua. Shua, S-H-U-A means Redeemer and Savior. Yahweh became the Redeemer and Savior through his right arm, which was revealed in Yahshua, which is in Isaiah 53. And whom was the arm, the authority, the right hand revealed? So let's come back to it quickly. So that the name Jesus never existed 2,000 years ago. Then they took the name, when the Gospels was translated between 100 and 127 AY, after Yahshua, the Roman Catholic Church translated the four Gospels. And they changed the name Yahshua to Isis, I-S-I-S. Who is Isis? Well, in the Egyptian term, it was Ra. In Genesis 10, it was Nimrod, the sun god. Then in Egyptian time it was Ra, the sun god. Then in the Greek time it was Zeus, the sun god. And then in the Roman time, Isis was the sun god. And what happened? They changed his name, Yahshua's name, to Isis. Between 100, it was in the 2nd century. They changed his name to Isis. And for 1,500 years, in all Roman Catholic Bibles, they never referred to Jesus, not once. Was all Isis. And then in the 16th century, the Roman Catholic Church, because of Protestantism, then they changed the name from Isis to Jesus. So there was no letter J. Now he says, the researcher says, now don't worry about understanding everything in that verse. I, when I read the Bible, I don't always want to understand anything in a verse. I want to understand not even everything in a word. I want to understand everything in a letter. And my students, which I have 240 of, first, second, third, and fourth year students, I teach them, you must read the letter. The word will come by itself, and the line and the verse will follow. But read the letter. See whether it's a small letter or a capital letter, because that already makes a difference. It's like in the 1611 King James Bible and the New King James Bible, your English-speaking people. The 1611 King James Bible would say, "Thou art God." Then in 1881, they created the Nestle Aland text, which is the West Cartonard text. And then they translated in 1881, they translated the first New King James. Now the reason there, they said that the 1611 King James was reading too difficult. Now English is my second language, and even sometimes I battle to pronounce. I can speak English, but sometimes I do not pronounce a certain word exactly as it should be. But it doesn't matter, it comes out and you understand what I'm saying. We are de-teaching the gospel. We're not running away. So, on the end of the day, the pronunciation of the word is one thing. But to teach the word and get to the message is very important. So when they translated the New King James, in the 1611 it says, "Thou art God." Thou means we worship you. Thou art God. The word thou means worship. If I take the word thou, it means bend down. It's like the 24 elders of four beasts. 24 elders put their crowns down in front of the throne and they worship thou. Oh, thou art Yahweh. I won't say God. Thou art the King of Kings. Thou art Yahweh. Our Elohim. And you understand what I'm saying? Thou means worship. Thou art great, the creator of heaven and earth. And now in the 1611, he comes and he says, "You are God." The International Standard Version, the Living Word, says, "You are God." Is thou and you the same word? Or is thou standing heads and shoulders above the word you when it comes to worshipping Yahweh? So we must understand that by changing the word, the value of the word you is like a young boy of 7 years will come to you and he will say, let's use my name, Hannes. He will say, "Oh, Hannes, how are you?" And his brother, who's the same age, will come and says, "Uncle Hannes." In Afrikaans is oom, or uncle, or Mr. Hannes. Who is actually respecting you more? Just by listening to the way that they address the person. And the same, that's why a lot of prayers doesn't get answered. Because you're not worshipping him in your prayers. You don't say, "Thou art my Redeemer." You are my Redeemer. "Thou art my Savior." You're my Savior. Does it make sense? No, it doesn't. You are belittling him. And I'm talking about the two Bibles, the 1611 King James Bible and the New King James. And between the 1611 King James Bible and New King James Bible, there are 9,000 scriptural changes. Did you know that? I'm a South African and I know it. There are 18 18 verses in the New King James Bible that just vanished. They're not even there comparing to the 1611 King James Bible. And now I'm talking about the International Version, Living Word, Jehovah Witness Bible, so we can carry on. 300 Bibles, which were English Bibles, that was translated from the West Cartonard text. where the scriptures just vanish into thin air, taken out. Where Revelation 22, I think it's verse 10 or 11, says you're not to change a comma or a point or anything or add anything or instruct everything. But Bible, the World Bible Society just changed the Bibles. And people are just happy to go with it. I don't. I address these matters all the time. So at the end of the time, to me it's what the Word says. Coming back, we will preach on a letter. Preach on a letter? Well, I can preach for 5 hours just on a letter J. How about that? Showing you that the name Jesus never exists for 2,000 years. Couldn't have existed. Impossible. So what did they use? They used ISIS. Oh, there's professors today in South Africa and doctors that says, but the I and the J sounds the same. Rubbish. The I and the J is the same letter. Rubbish. They've got different word or letter values. The I and the J. Isis and Jesus. No, it was, you know, and I'm closing down, I'm a bit off the point here, but I'm closing down. When Saul was walking the road of Damascus, he says, and somebody spoke out of heaven, I'm going to say somebody, spoke out of heaven, and he says, Jesus, what I have to do with, he couldn't have said Jesus, because the word Jesus only was created in the 16th century. And if you go read the scripture, I think it's Acts 20, 21. He says, and the voice in heaven spoke to Saul in a Hebrew language. Jesus is a Greek word. It's not the Hebrew word. And that was only created in Greek in the 16th century. 1524 to be exactly. By a Roman Catholic priest, Jesuit order priest from French. France. So, the Yahushua spoke to Saul, who became Apostle Paul. He spoke to him in a Hebrew tongue, in a Hebrew language. Now, yeah, time has caught up with us. Interesting, when we get busy with Bible studies, it's so fascinating when we can go into the Word and see how church dogma and teachings and theology has changed the Word to something that is like meat without salt. It's tasteless. But I found in this time we're living in the end time, people like just to be part of a church or a denomination or organization and just cruise along. They must just feel good. No. You must have an experience in the Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh. Till next week, if it's Yahweh's will, Maranatha. Yahushua is coming back again. Hallelujah.